First Chronicles chapter 17, let's begin with the 23rd verse. David praying, "And now, Lord, let the promise you have made concerning your servant and his house be established forever. Do as you promised, so that it will be established and that your name will be great forever. Then men will say, 'The Lord Almighty, the God over Israel, is Israel's God.' And the house of your servant David will be established before you. You, my God, have revealed to your servant that you will build a house for him, so that your servant has found courage to pray to you. O Lord, you are God. You have promised these good things to your servant. Now you have been pleased to bless the house of your servant, that it may continue forever in the sight. For you, O Lord, have blessed it, and it will be blessed forever." What you pray for will determine the kind of life you will have. If you pray one of these barely get by prayers, "Oh God, just let me just be able to eke out a living," that's the kind of life you're going to have. "Oh God, let me just take away half the pain in my body and I'll carry the rest," then that's the life you're going to have. "God, you know, just let me be able to make just enough money for me and my family and I'll be happy," then that's the kind of life you're going to have. But in the Bible, I've never found that God takes pleasure in us praying small prayers. I find in the Bible, God wants us to pray big prayers. Consider Elijah. He prayed that it would not rain for 3.5 years, and it didn't rain. Consider Joshua. He prayed for more sunlight, and God stopped the sun for almost a full day. Consider Elisha, when the Arameans were taking him captive, he prayed that they would not recognize him, and God caused them to go blind. These men prayed big prayers, not just small prayers. It's easy to pray, "Let me get by." You almost don't need God to answer that prayer. But when you pray something big, "God, let me be a big blessing. God, make our marriage be better than it was when we were first married." Some of you would be happy if you can get back to your first 2 years. But when you pray big prayers, God honors that kind of prayer. David is praying a big prayer. He just heard that God is going to give him a dynasty, that his kingship would last forever, that he will never fail to have a son on his throne. What a big prayer. Because things change. How would he be able to see that fulfillment? But David said, "Do as you've promised." So here's the thing. What has God revealed to your spirit? What is he telling you that he wants to do in your life? Then pray those big prayers. I read the story of a young man named Victor. Victor and his family, his mother moved from, I believe it was Puerto Rico, if I'm not mistaken, and they moved to the Bronx in New York. Well, as soon as they moved, Victor got messed up with the gangs, got messed up, and started taking heroin. He got addicted to heroin. Now, Victor's mother could have prayed a simple prayer because she was a Christian. She could have said, "God, just get my son off of heroin. Just don't let him die. Don't let him overdose." But no, Victor's mom had a big plan for Victor. She began to pray Holy Ghost prayers. She came up to Victor one day when he was on heroin. She laid hands on him and said, "Victor, the hand of God is upon you. I have been praying that God makes you a minister of the gospel." She wasn't satisfied him just getting off of drugs, but a minister of the gospel. Well, God heard her prayers. God spoke to a man named David Wilkerson and sent him to New York. And David Wilkerson had a call to minister to the gangs in New York. And there was Victor Torres, who heard the gospel from David Wilkerson. He gave his life to the Lord. And today, Victor Torres is a pastor of a great church. It was a mother who prayed a big prayer. Not just keep him safe, don't let him overdose, but Lord, make him a minister of the gospel. What kind of prayer are you praying? You know, I feel like the devil's been lying to some of you. You've had the devil tell you, you don't have the right connections for God to bring you into greatness. You don't have enough funding for you to start that fund or that ministry. You know, you're not talented enough. You're not good enough. You made too many mistakes. You come to the wrong family. You're not the best at that. But you don't have to be the best. You just need to be the most persistent. You know, when Sonia and I came back from Hillsong, we went to the graduation of my son Caleb. And listen, this graduation at Hillsong was no graduation that I've ever been to. How many of us have ever been invited to graduations and out of obligation we say, yes, we'll go, but come on, we drudge it. Oh, man. But I knew this graduation was going to be different because the moment it started, they had a Broadway presentation. These singers sing, I'm thinking, this is fun already. And it was great. I especially enjoyed the message from Pastor Brian Houston. He gave a message that touched me. He said, there are four things that I learned in Bible college, and it was the first one that touched me the most. He said, I learned this. You don't have to be the best. You just have to be the most persistent. And Brian said, I wasn't the best student. I was by far the best, by far way behind the best student. But I was the most persistent. I made sure that I wasn't going to give up. And that's why God was able to use me, not because I'm the best. And some of you, you're not the brightest. You're not the smartest. People say, well, Bishop, I think you're pretty smart. Listen to me. I was the 90% of the class that made the 10% valedictorian possible, you know? No, but I was persistent. I believed in a big God. And you don't have to be the smartest. You don't have to be the most talented, most gifted. But you have to be the person who says, I believe in a big God. God doesn't answer just smart people's prayers. In fact, sometimes smart people's prayers are usually not answered. But because God chooses the foolish things of this world to shame the wise. God chose David. In fact, in this prayer, David said, who am I that our family should be picked for this? We're not even from a very special family. And who am I? I'm the youngest son of my father. See, back in biblical times, it was the oldest son that was usually honored, but God chose the last son to be honored. And God is signifying, it doesn't matter if you're in the back of the class, if you'll pray to a big God, he'll move you into the front of the class. Not because you're smarter or better than anyone, but because you believe in a big God that can turn things around in your life. And that's what I learned from Pastor Houston. Is you don't need to be the best. You just need to be persistent and trust in a big God. So what has the devil been lying to you about? You're not big enough. You're not smart enough. You don't have enough breaks. You come from the wrong family. I don't know about you. We all come from the wrong family. It's called the Adamic family. But I got born again into a better family called the Jesus family. Amen. But here's my message to you. What will you dare to ask God to do in your life? I would have never pictured 30 years ago that I would one day be a bishop under apostolic succession, that I would have a diocese of 80 churches, thousands of people looking at me as their bishop. I would have never pictured that. But I did believe in a big God, and I did ask him, take whatever talent I have, whatever abilities, and use me for your glory. Do something big in my life. God can take the most insignificant person and make them significant. But you got to believe in a big God.